These are recycled 18650 cells. Today I'm going to show you how to build them into a custom battery to power your next awesome project. Lithium batteries are very dangerous if not treated correctly. They can pose a significant explosion and fire hazard. Please consult a professional before attempting these procedures. These 18650 cells are more common than you might think. There's a whole hobby around getting them and building them into custom batteries to power cool projects. Unfortunately, there is a significant safety hazard if you don't know what you're doing. This video guide is intended to get you up to speed on the topic, and we'll start by explaining exactly what an 18650 is. This is an 18650 cell, named so because it's approximately 18mm in diameter and approximately 65mm in length. Overall, it's much like the cells that we use in normal electronics. Just like this AA cell, it has a positive and negative terminal, the difference being that these are alkaline, but our 18650 is typically lithium ion. Similar to a lithium polymer RC hobby battery, or inside our tablet or mobile phone, but in 18650 format, they are pretty much everywhere. For instance, cordless power tool battery packs inside have an array of 18650s. Portable power banks used for charging phones, well guess what, inside they're powered by 18650s. There's a very good chance that the battery in your laptop has an array of 18650s too. 18650 cells and variants of different sizes are actually what is typically configured to form electric vehicle batteries. Manufacturers use 18650 batteries for many products, but us hobbyists can also build custom batteries. My example for this video will be a custom shaped 24 volt battery to power this 3D printer. Let's proceed by talking about voltages, current draw and capacity. Our first parameter is voltage. Most people are familiar with this term, and we just need to match our battery to our object, for instance 24 volts for a 3D printer. Next is current measured in amps, and that's how much electricity is actually flowing. This will vary depending on what you're powering. For instance, an LED will use very little, whereas a motor or heater will use a lot. Finally, we have our capacity in amp hours, or sometimes watt hours. And what I'm talking about here is how long the battery will last for. A 2 amp hour battery will supply 1 amp of current for 2 hours, or half an amp for 4 hours, and so forth. For a single cell, the nominal voltage is 3.7 volts, and you should think about this as a working voltage. That's because when fully charged, the cell will be 4.2 volts, and fully depleted at 3.2 volts, where it will need a recharge. Here's a simplified graph of how the battery discharges. It will start at 4.2 volts when full, but very quickly drop to 3.7 or 3.8, slowly decline until it gets to 3.2, and then drop off a cliff. A fully charged cell might be 4.2 volts, but it's much better to plan around the nominal 3.7 volts. But 3.7 volts isn't enough to power most projects, so how do we fix this? The first connection we can make is called series, where we stack the cells positive to negative. When we do this, the voltage is added together for each cell, but we can't draw any additional current and our runtime won't be any longer. What is pictured here would be called 2S and will yield 7.4 nominal volts. Here's what we would call 4S, which yields 14.8 volts. The other type of connection we can make is called parallel, where we have the cells alongside each other, positive to positive and negative to negative. When we do this, our voltage remains unchanged, but the available current and the capacity is added for each cell. What we're seeing here would be called 2P. It's still 3.7 volts, but this battery can supply twice the current of a single cell and will last twice as long. This example is called 3P, still 3.7 volts, but triple the current and runtime. Of course, we can use a combination of series and parallel cells to achieve our desired outcome. Pictured here is 2S3P, because there's two cells in series to make 7.4 volts, and three in parallel to triple our current and capacity. Here is 3S2P to make an 11.1 volt battery, and here is 4S4P, because there's four cells in series and also four in parallel. We can connect the individual cells into a battery to suit our project, but how do we know exactly what arrangement we need? Well, here's how I worked it out for my portable Monoprice Mini Delta. I wanted to convert the printer to 24 volts, and 6 times 3.7 volts is 22.2 volts. Therefore, I would need a 6S system. After disconnecting the 12 volt heated bed, and changing the heater cartridge as well as all of the fans from 12 to 24 volt. I run the machine with the nozzle up to temp and the stepper motors energized, and figured at most I needed 2 amps. It's hard to find an 18650 cell that can't support at least 10 amps continuous draw, so for me it was all about fitting as many cells as I could in to increase the capacity. So I mocked up where the cells would fit and found that I could fit 7 per side. That gives me 7P, and the two combined gives me a 6S 7P LiPo battery. What about instead we're calculating for a high current DC motor? If it were a 36 volt motor that drew 80 amps peak, we would need 10 cells in series to make 37 volts, and if we were looking at cells that could safely supply 10 amps, we'd need 8 of those in parallel to make 80 amps, giving us a battery of 10S 8P. But what if instead we were looking at cells that could supply 20 amps safely? In that case, we'd only need 4 in parallel, making the battery 10S 4P. Again, that's the minimum, and it doesn't guarantee that the motor will run for very long. So it might be better to have more batteries in parallel if you can fit them. Out of these three, in terms of safety, it's the current draw that is the crucial one. You'll see quite often a current rating for a battery, but when you investigate further, you'll see that this is a pulse discharge, and this might only be safe for a split second. So instead, look for continuous discharge when calculating your battery. If your project is drawing more current than your cells can handle, the cells will firstly overheat, and then there's a fair chance they will fail in a very dangerous way. Using more cells in parallel is much safer. Let's consider a project that needs 10 amps continuous. Technically, we could power it with a cell capable of 10 amps continuous discharge, but this means the cell will be running at its max rating non-stop, it's going to run very hot, and its lifespan will be greatly diminished. If we were to expand to 4P instead, the load is shared between parallel cells, and therefore each one is running much cooler and supplying 2.5 amps, with a bonus that our battery will run for much longer before being depleted. What I'd highly recommend to confirm your battery configuration is using a calculator like this and entering all of the details. Put in how many in series as well as parallel, and it will confirm to you the voltage, the maximum amps, and the capacity. By now we've worked out our battery configuration and how many individual cells we need, so you might think we're ready to purchase, but unfortunately there's some pitfalls to look out for there too. When it comes to 18650 cells, there's a lot of dodgy stuff going on and a lot of dangerous false advertising. Cell ratings are vastly exaggerated, and we know that if we ask too much of them, it can end in disaster. There's a wide range of cells available, and of course there's variation between these cells in terms of their specs. We are focusing on lithium ion cells here, but a rule of thumb still applies. Cells are either optimized for high current or high capacity, but not both. In terms of safe continuous discharge, the most you'll see is around 30 amps, but the capacity will only be 1500 milliamp hours. And the highest actual capacity you'll find is 3500 milliamp hours, but these cells will only be capable of 10 amps continuous discharge. When you see a cell claiming to have 30,000 milliamps of capacity or 40 to 60 amps of discharge, run the other way as fast as you can to avoid the inevitable. I would highly advise sticking with established manufacturers such as LG, Samsung, Sony, Panasonic, etc. They make products that might be more expensive, but offer a good mix between capacity as well as maximum discharge rate. But of course, there's plenty of substandard fakes around that can catch you out. Fortunately, people such as Mooch make guides on how to distinguish the fake from the genuine. Unfortunately, you do need the cells in your possession before you're able to inspect them closely. So I would recommend hitting up forums and community groups to do some background research on sellers. I'm only willing to suggest a seller I have personal experience with, so in Australia, my recommendation is Tech Around You. They had an excellent reputation online, and my experience was also positive. Their prices for individual cells are fairly high, but if you buy in bulk for a large project, the prices drop substantially. I purchased a large quantity of VTC4s for another project. They arrived quickly, and I was able to verify that they were genuine. So far we've talked about new cells, but the cells I used for this 3D printer battery were actually secondhand. In my case, I got 80 cells for $100 from eBay. The problem with secondhand is you don't know exactly what you'll be getting, but they'll most likely be salvaged from laptop batteries, which means low discharge and high capacity, but with possible wear and tear. If you want to find the exact specs of the cells you receive, there's great websites like Second Life Storage, where you can input the text and look up the color to try and match your cells. Even so, I'd still err on the side of caution, and unless you're absolutely sure, assume the cells can only discharge around 10 amps. It's just not worth the risk if you overestimate the cells. Of course, you might be able to get some 18650s for free by salvaging them from laptop batteries, power banks, power tool batteries, etc. And if you are working with used cells, there's some checks that you really should do before proceeding. For secondhand 18650 cells, I'd recommend using an intelligent charger such as this Opus C3100. You can use it as a smart charger for individual cells, but you can also use it to safely discharge the cells before charging them back up and recording how much capacity they actually have. It took some time, but I was able to test all of my secondhand cells. I entered these values into a spreadsheet and found there was quite a big disparity between the best and the worst cells. To use them safely, we can then enter these values into repacker.com, as well as the number of cells in series and parallel, and this fantastic free website will tell you exactly how to pack them in your battery to even out the values. If you've purchased new cells from a verified source, you should be able to use them straight out of the box without any testing. We're now up to the actual building of the battery. If you search online, you'll find cheap clip-together modular cell holders that will let you build up a frame for your battery. If you have a 3D printer, you'll find many free designs on Thingiverse and other sites. I decided to design and print a custom frame. You can see that this will ensure there's a little gap between each cell. Some people prefer to butt them up against each other and then use hot glue to hold them in place, but personally I think that's too risky. On the rare chance that the cells are damaged on the outside, we know what's going to happen. Having a small air gap around each of the cells should also assist in keeping them cool. You may have noticed that the professional batteries have the cells joined together with metal strips. The metal strips we need to use should be pure nickel, not nickel-plated steel, which is sometimes dishonestly sold in its place. It comes in various thicknesses as well as widths. The spec of strip you need is going to depend on your battery, and we can use a table like this one from Matador to work out what we need. If we come to nickel, we can see that even the thinnest strip can support 2.1 amps. This is more than my printer will draw, but if I had a more demanding application, I would need to move down in terms of width and thickness to support more amperage. It's also worth noting that the series and parallel connections have different requirements. In this 20 amp battery, we have 4 cells in parallel, so the nickel strip in between them only has to handle 5 amps each. However, the nickel used for the series connections have to take the full 20 amps in between each parallel group and for the terminals on each end. It's always best to play it safe and use multiple larger nickel strips where you can. This is an area of battery building where a lot of people don't do any calculations and just use generic thin strip. I don't know why you would leave that to chance. To join the nickel strips to the cells, we need a spot welder, and I chose the K-Weld, which wasn't the cheapest, but it had very consistent and good reviews. It's priced just above 150 euros, comes in an easy to assemble kit, and there are distributors all over the world, including in Australia. I chose to power mine from a high power RC LiPo, and free accessories are available, such as this laser cut acrylic case that I made myself. As these were used batteries, there were little bumps where the previous nickel strips had been removed, so before any spot welding, I carefully removed them with a Dremel tool. The online manual has the calibration process, as well as the recommended power settings for different thickness nickel strips. I experimented with these, practicing on a spare cell, verifying the strip was welded on correctly by trying to tear it off with some pliers. And a warning here, the edges of these nickel strips are incredibly sharp, so please take care. After this, I cut some nickel strips and started to weld my parallel connections. Starting with some straight strips, before then switching to diagonals to join these up, upping the power of the welder for the second strip. Soon one side of parallel connections was done, so I flipped the battery and repeated for the second side, completing all of my parallel connections. Next comes the crucial series connections, and you need to double check before making each one to join the correct positive to negative terminals of the parallel groups. Remember that as you make more connections, the more dangerous the battery becomes, and dropping something metallic across the terminals can short the battery, and we know how that ends. Eventually, all of my nickel strips were spot welded in place, and I was able to verify my battery by using a multimeter. I labeled the polarity of the terminals to avoid magic smoke issues later. If you really don't want to muck around with spot welding, there is another option in the Veruzend battery building kits. They come with plastic parts that clip together, and these have a screw terminal on top where we use pre-cut strips to join the cells up and build up our battery. This is very convenient, but for a big battery, the price is going to add up quickly. At this stage, technically I had a custom battery that could power my printer, but it's not really complete until we add the final wiring. Let's have a look at a regular RC LiPo, and obviously we have our main positive and negative terminals, but we also have this extra lead, which is for balanced charging. And that's because batteries with 2S or more must be balanced charged. If we only connect the main terminals to the battery charger, the parallel groups will recharge, but there's nothing to prevent them from being unbalanced, and that is unsafe. So what we need to do is to add the wires for balanced charging. The first one goes to negative, and then there'll be a wire for the positive of each parallel group. When we charge the battery, we can now connect this, which will allow the charger to ensure that each parallel group goes to exactly 4.2 volts, and therefore balanced and safe. If you use a multimeter, you can confirm where each of the terminals are that you need to add a wire to. You can then prepare the terminal by roughing it up, adding some rosin flux paste, and then soldering a wire to the terminal. You'll note here I'm soldering away from the tips of the cells, as excessive heat will damage them, and that's the reason we spot weld rather than solder the nickel strips. With all of the balance wires soldered on and labelled, one for ground and one for the positive terminal of each parallel group, we can commence with some cable management. This stuff is called fish paper. It's like paper tape used for electrical insulation. We can cut as many strips as we need to go in between the wires and the nickel strips, preventing them from being moved around and severed. Kapton or polyamide tape is also suitable for holding the wires down and preventing any movement. After protecting all of the balance wires on either side of the battery, I was then able to solder on my main terminal wires, again using the rosin paste to reduce the amount of time the solder needs to flow. I then crimped on the terminating pins and plugged them into a JST connector to match the port of my LiPo charger. Finally, it was time to screw on my 3D printed lids, which I designed with cutouts for these wires to exit. For the main terminals, I soldered on parallel XT60 plugs, one to remain permanently connected to the printer and the other one for the charger. And with that step, my custom 18650 battery is complete. Here are the final specs. It's 6S7P, 22.2 volts nominal, with a repacker calculated capacity of 12.5 amp hours. It should be capable of delivering 70 amps, but the printer draws less than 2, which means each cell only sees 0.29 amps. When printing, it should run for 8 hours, and sitting idle, about 60. I had to reprint the lower housing to accommodate this battery, but that was a minor inconvenience, and everything is working as planned. There's one more component that I haven't used on this build, but we need to cover briefly, and that is a BMS. I've designed my battery to be charged from an external hobby RC charger, but sometimes a better option is to use one of these. This is a BMS or battery management system. The main terminals are connected in series with the battery, and the smaller wires connect to the parallel groups, just like our balanced charger plug. Remember our discharge graph, where when the battery was depleted, the voltage fell off a cliff? If you keep discharging from this point, you can damage the battery permanently, so one of the jobs of the BMS is to monitor this and cut off the power. Other safety features include stopping the battery from becoming overcharged, drawing too much current, short circuits, or getting too hot. All the conditions that can potentially lead to a catastrophic failure. Some BMSs offer a Bluetooth interface, so you can monitor all aspects of the battery from a mobile device. The battery in this printer has a pretty easy time, and a BMS will be hard to fit, so I've left it out. However, I do have another project coming up on the channel that needs this absolute unit. If you're after more info on the rest of the cordless conversion for a 3D printer, I do have a previous video on that linked below. If you are going to build your own battery, please pay attention to the safety warning, because if it goes wrong, it can go really, really wrong. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, happy custom 18650 battery building.
G'day, it's Michael again. If you like the video, then please click like. If you want to see more content like this in future, click subscribe, and make sure you click on the bell to receive every notification. If you really want to support the channel and see exclusive content, become a patron. Visit my Patreon page. See you next time.